are discussing how to realize a voltage control voltage source of gain 1 using a MOS transistor, and using the idea of negative feedback, it was quite easy to derive. What we came up with was this circuit where the input is applied to the gate of the MOS transistor and the output or the load is connected between the source terminal and ground, and the drain is not used, it is just connected to incremental ground. Okay. So, if this is the case, we know that the output voltage will be the input voltage times GMRL by 1 plus GMRL, which means that this will be almost Vi if GM is much more than 1 by RL. The transconductance has to be much more than the load conductance, that is the idea. If that is the case, the loop gain of this negative feedback loop will be very high and you get a gain that is very close to 1. Now, this is just the incremental picture. Always whatever function we want to realize will be some linear function, and we first try to derive the incremental linear picture corresponding to that function, and then we combine it with some suitable bias arrangement. And as far as biasing is concerned, it appeared that source feedback biasing, where the source is not connected to a small signal ground, is the most convenient, because in our incremental circuit as well, the source is not connected to ground. Okay. So, we have this biasing arrangement and this signal picture. So, we have to apply the input signal, that is the combination of Vi and Rs, to this circuit and also connect the load to that circuit. How do we do that? How do we connect the input source? What should I do? We have to AC couple, that seems like the easiest thing, and in fact to generate this VG0, what we do is to use a resistive divider. And to connect the input source, we use this idea of AC coupling, which we have done many times before. Okay. If you choose R1 and R2 to be much larger than Rs, the voltage here will be the DC bias value VG0 plus the input voltage Vi. Okay. This assumes that Vi is of some frequency more than 0. Okay. If that is the case, given the signal frequency, you can always find a capacitor C1 that is large enough that the voltage drop across it is very small in the incremental sense. Okay. How do we connect the load? Again, we can use a capacitor to couple the load to the transistor. Okay. So, again, if C2 is large enough, it will behave like a short circuit for frequencies above, frequencies which are for the signal frequency. So, RL will appear directly between the source and ground of the source of the MOS transistor and ground. Okay. The drain anyway is connected to small signal ground, here it is connected to the supply voltage. So, that is already correctly connected. Okay. So, this is all the circuit we need to make. Okay. Yeah. So, in that case you cannot use capacitors. Okay. What you have to make sure is that you can connect a source between this and ground without using AC coupling, without using capacitors. You have to make sure that it has the correct DC value as well as the signal. So, somehow you have to arrange for it. No, even without putting in series, probably, I mean by using some other stage, probably you could arrange for that. Okay. And similarly, here this load should be able to operate with this bias voltage. Okay. So it is possible to, let's say you have a certain DC bias value and some signal. It's possible to change only the DC bias value and not the signal by using some circuits. Okay, so you have to use those things if that's required. We'll come to those circuits later, so we'll see. Any questions about this? So this is the complete circuit, and if you look at it, the input is connected between gate and ground, and the drain is also grounded. So you can say that the input is connected between gate and drain. The output is taken between source and drain, okay, because the drain is grounded. A drain is the common terminal to the input and output. So this amplifier is known as a common drain amplifier, okay. Now, also if you think about it in the large signal sense, first of all, what is the quiescent current flowing in the transistor M1? I0, okay. So now, it will have a gate source voltage, which is, how much is that? What will be the gate source voltage of M1? What is it? What's that? What is the gate source voltage of M1? It is carrying a current I0. So what's the gate source voltage? Yeah, it's the, why this is just the threshold voltage plus the overdrive, right? Square root of 2 I0 by mu and C aux W by L. Okay. Now the total voltage here at the gate is VDD times R2 by R1 plus R2, which is the quiescent voltage, plus VI. Okay, here I have assumed that the capacitor C1 is a short at the signal frequency, and also that R1 and R2 are much more than RS. Okay, so if that is the case, this is the voltage, and the voltage here would be this voltage minus VGS. Okay. In fact, we assume that as the signal changes, the current through the MOS transistor changes, because there is some current going into the load. If you neglect those small variations, then you can assume that the current through the MOS transistor is always I0, even as the signal is changing. Okay. So if the current through the MOS transistor is I0, this gate source voltage will be fixed. Okay. So the total output voltage here will be the same as at the gate minus the gate source voltage. Okay. So the waveform shape will be exactly the same, but it will have shifted down. Okay. So here it will be whatever voltage we have there, VDD R2 by R1 plus R2 minus VT minus this whole thing in the square root, and this whole entire voltage plus VI. Okay. It will have a different DC bias level, but it will have the same signal variations. Okay. This is another way of saying incrementally the gate source voltage is 0. Okay. What does it mean to say incrementally the gate source voltage is 0? It means that the total gate source voltage does not change with signal. Okay. Isn't it? When we analyzed it incrementally earlier, we said that if the GM value is very large, then the gate and source are incrementally shorted, virtually shorted. Okay. So the gate source voltage, the gate source incremental voltage is 0. Now, if you look at the total voltage, what does it mean? The total voltage does not change. That is the meaning of it. Okay. Is this fine? And if you think about it, if there is some variation in the gate voltage increases, the source voltage follows that thing. Okay. It follows the gate voltage. So this circuit is also known as a source follower. So that is just the terminology. You will most often see this circuit referred to as the source follower. Okay, source follower basically is a voltage controlled voltage source of gain 1. Okay, any questions about the circuit? What are the constraints on C1 and C2 so that they behave like short circuits? C1 must be much greater than what? The signal frequency is omega. The resistance that appears across it is RS plus R1 parallel R2. Okay. And what about C2? RL? RL plus 1 by GM. Okay. So, looking this way you have RL and looking that way you have 1 by GM, which is the output resistance of this circuit. So, C2 must be much greater than 1 over omega times RS plus 1 by GM. Okay. That's fine. So, with this you should be able to design a source follower. Given a load resistance RL, you can choose GM. GM has to be much greater than the load conductance. Okay. Now, how much greater should it be? It depends on how close you want the gain to be to 1. And after that, you can choose the rest of the parameters. From the transconductance, you know the bias current and you know the gate bias voltage and so on. Yes? RL, yeah, thanks. So, this should be RL, yeah, same. Okay, so quite a simple circuit, and this type of biasing suits it very well, the source feedback biasing. So, you apply the signal to the gate and you take the signal from the source. The output resistance is quite small, it is 1 by GM, and then you can connect a load to it. Essentially, this acts like a buffer. Okay. And this buffer is very commonly used even in microphones like this, because microphone is very small and it has a very high output, equivalent output resistance. So, immediately after the microphone there will be a buffer that is used and it is of this type. Okay. Any questions about this? Yeah, so that's what I was saying. So, let's say that this is the amplifier of interest, and you have something that comes before and something that comes after. Okay. So, let's say this input bias has to be VI bias, and the input signal must be riding around that bias. Okay, that VI bias is required to establish the correct operating point in this. Okay. Now, if you arrange for this amplifier to have an output bias voltage which is the same as VI bias, then you can surely connect them together. And similarly, this will have some output bias voltage. If the following stage works properly with this bias voltage, then you can connect it directly. Okay. So, right now I am not worried, I am not concerning myself with what is connected before and after. Okay. So, I do not know what they are, So the safe thing is to connect them through capacitors, basically do AC coupling. But of course, this means that you can't use this amplifier for DC. So if you do want to use it for DC, you do have to make sure that the output bias level of one stage is compatible with the input bias level of the following stage, okay? And there are ways to manipulate that as well, okay? So for instance, let's say that this VI bias, maybe let me put some numbers, that's easier. So let's say this is 3 volts plus VI, okay? And this bias happened to be 6 volts, okay? So how would I? It gives me 6 volts plus whatever VI, okay? So how would I connect these two? I can do AC coupling, of course, but what else can I do? But then the other amplifier may not work with 6 volts. I mean, this won't work with 6 volts. Resistive divider, okay. So I could take this and have R and R. What will I get here? I get 3 volts plus VI by 2. The disadvantage is I get VI by 2. I am losing half the gain. Okay, I don't want to do this. What else can I do? Yeah, but I mean, the idea is not to use a capacitor so that it works for DC. Inductor, how will you drop a voltage across an inductor? What is it that you really need? I mean, if you had all the freedom you want, what element would you select? Battery. Basically, you had to have a 3 volt battery, okay? But you don't have that. So there are many ways to kind of mimic the action. Yeah, that's a possibility. I mean, he is saying use a diode. How many diodes will you need? If you put 4, maybe you will get, what will be the voltage here? If this is 6 volts plus VI, what will be the voltage there? 3.2. So let's say that's close enough, plus VI, why? Is it exactly constant? It will be, if each one has an incremental resistance RD, this will be VI times R by R plus 4 times RD, right? I mean, the incremental resistance of a diode is not 0, it may be small. Oh yeah, this also works. I mean, 3.2 may be close enough for you to get it to work. There are many other ways. One is to use the circuit that we just discussed. So let's say we have 6 volts plus VI, okay, and we choose the bias current such that VGS is 3 volts, okay, this is possible, right? What's the bias current? This must be out the tip of your tongue to get 3 volts VGS for our MOS transistor, 200 microamperes. So this is if MOS transistor has these parameters. Okay, so we have 6 volts plus VI, what will you get here? 3 volts plus VI if it is not loaded. If it is loaded, you will get 3 volts plus VI times GMRL by 1 plus GMRL. So that's another possibility. You can try various things. I mean, it's always, there's no unique solution to design, but some will work better than others. Another way to get a constant voltage drop is to try and do this. You have to make sure that I naught times R is 3 volts, okay? Or rather, let me just show it like this. This I naught is drawn from this block, okay? Now that shouldn't affect this block. If that is guaranteed, then you can use something like this, or you can also have I naught from the top. This current source will not be exactly equal to this. The difference will have to flow into this circuit. This block has to be able to absorb the difference, okay? So this is I naught plus delta, so delta will go there. So it has to be able to absorb that delta without affecting the function, okay? If that's the case, what will you get here? What is the voltage? What is it? 3 volts? Plus VA, that's all, right? I mean, this is acting like a battery of 3 volts, I naught R is 3 volts, so that's all. So this is 3 volts plus VI. So there are many ways to do this. So you are also asking about this. This is how you can, but if you do this DC coupling, you have to make sure that the levels are compatible, and you may have to insert what are known as level shifters. This source follower is also used as a level shifter many times, okay, so that you get the same signal but around a different DC bias value, okay. Any other questions? Buffer. Yeah, buffer is a voltage controlled voltage source of gain 1, right? No, I mean infinite value will be like a battery which will never lose its voltage, right? If it's high value, if you wait long enough, it will lose its charge, okay? Now we have a constraint on frequency, right? What does it mean? We use this constraint all the time. We said that omega C 1 must be much greater than 1 over R s plus R 1 parallel R 2, okay? Now, let's say V I is a sinusoid. The voltage across this will also be a sinusoid, okay? In steady state, the voltage across the capacitor V C 1 will also be a sinusoid. It will look like that, okay? Now, its amplitude is small enough, if its amplitude is small enough, that is, it will be the case if this condition is satisfied, then you neglect that from Kirchhoff's voltage law, right? Essentially, all of this V I gets dropped across R s and R 1 parallel R 2. So, essentially, within one cycle of the input between here and there, the variation in the signal is, variation in the voltage across C 1 is very small, that is the idea. But if you make the signal wider and wider, you will always reach some point where this voltage becomes very large, okay? For instance, let us take the extreme case of DC, right? Let me do this, it goes from 0 to 1 volt. What happens eventually? It may take long, it may take a short time, it may take milliseconds or hours, but eventually this VC 1 will reach 1 volt, okay? And the output will be 0, isn't it? What will be the steady state output if I apply DC here? 0, okay? The voltage across the capacitor will be initially 0 and then it will build up like that, okay? So, with a finite valued capacitor, you can never emulate a battery exactly. You can only emulate something like a battery if the signal frequency is higher than something, okay? Then the voltage across the capacitor does vary, but because the input is a sinusoid, this also varies sinusoidally. It is periodic and that amplitude is very small. But if you do apply a DC, this there is no bound here, right? It will block the signal completely. Any other questions? Previous slide. No, no, I said, okay, that I didn't explain. What I meant was you can never be able to make two current sources exactly the same. So, even if you make them nominally equal, one will be slightly different from the other, okay? No, I don't use I naught plus delta. If I try to make I naught, I will get I naught plus delta. Otherwise, this the current will be flowing into this buffer, right? So, the buffer will have to deliver that current as well as work properly. If that is the case, it is fine. Otherwise, if I do have I naught, remember no current is flowing out of this, right? So, you are not loading that stage, that is the reason to use I naught, okay? Anything else? There are many ways, I mean, you can find lots of ways of eventually achieving this goal. Maybe you do not have a separate block which will translate the level, that is, which will take you from 3 volts plus 6 volts plus V I to 3 volts plus V I. But you can probably make some design changes within this so that it accepts 6 volt plus V I without, I mean, while still operating correctly, okay? We will make DC coupled circuits. The op amp that we will eventually make will be DC coupled because it has to work for DC as well, okay? But when we are discussing isolated stages, it is easier to assign some bias at the input and output without worrying about what comes before and what comes after, okay? Anything else? Yeah, this is quite a simple block. It is one of the basic building blocks. In many cases, you see the common drain amplifier also listed as one of the basic building blocks along with the common source. But here we did it slightly differently. I am highlighting the fact that this has feedback, whereas common source amplifier, there is no feedback. Okay, in that sense, they are quite different from each other. Okay. So, if there are no questions about the voltage controlled voltage source, we can move on to the next type. So, let us say voltage controlled current source. Now, this may look a little weird. I mean, what is there to do? I mean, the MOSFET is already a voltage controlled current source. So, here the idea is to, what does a voltage controlled current source, what does its transfer characteristic look like? It is represented by the output current Iout being some parameter GM, which has dimensions of conductance times the incremental input Vi. Okay. Now, a MOS transistor by itself is a voltage controlled current source, that is perfectly fine. That is exactly what it is, right? VGS, GM VGS, that is all you have. Now, like I said, this GM is quite sensitive to temperature and variations of other kind, right, between different MOS transistors. Now, let us say you want this constant of proportionality to be independent of those things, okay. You do not want it to be sensitive to temperature and so on. So, in that case, you will have to realize it differently, because if you just use a MOS transistor, it will be sensitive to temperature, it will be, I mean, you use different MOS transistors, you will get different values and so on. So, let us say I want to avoid that excessive sensitivity to this transistor parameters. So, I want this proportionality constant to be defined by, let us say, a resistor which can be controlled accurately. Okay. So, that is the idea behind this. So, I want to realize a voltage controlled current source using a MOS transistor using negative feedback, so that the constant of proportionality does not vary with temperature, and I could have slightly different MOS transistors, that is MOS transistors from, let us say you take 1000 MOS transistors, they will have slightly different characteristics. I put any of them, I should get nearly the same proportionality constant and so on. So, it is not as stupid as it sounds. There is a reason to make a voltage controlled current source using a MOS transistor, and here the idea is to implement it using negative feedback. Okay. Any questions? So, I will say using negative feedback. Now, once I say I use negative feedback, I have to define some error based on which I control the output, okay, isn't it? That is the essence of negative feedback. I take the difference between the desired output and the actual output, or some representation of it, some scaled version of it, or some representation of the difference between desired and actual outputs, and then I control the output based on this difference, okay, and in a direction that will reduce the error. Okay. So, that is negative feedback. And how do I implement it with a transistor? I know that a MOS transistor responds to the gate source voltage. So, the error voltage that I define must be the gate source voltage. Okay. So, that will control the current, and the output current will drive the output quantity. In this case, the output is current itself, but if it is a voltage, you push the current into a node. These things we have discussed, right? So, what is the error voltage that I would define? What is it that I have? First of all, I have the input source, which is a voltage source Vi, and maybe I have some load, and the output current must flow through the load. Okay. Now, what is a suitable error that I can define, which I can give to the MOS transistor so that it controls the output current? Remember, the MOS transistor responds to gate source voltage. So, any error that I define has to be in the form of a voltage difference, right? I think any equation can be written as in that form, right? F of x equal to 0, that is the standard way of writing the equation. and you can say this is the error, and you can scale this, you can manipulate this in some way, you can invert all the terms. All kinds of things are possible while still keeping, while still respecting the same equation. Okay. So now the relationship that I want to implement is that. Okay. From there I have to extract an error which will basically tell me the deviation from this expression. What is that? And of course, I also have the practical constraint that my MOS transistor responds to voltages, so that error has to be a voltage. What can I define as the error? Vi minus I naught by Gm. Yeah. So it's pretty obvious from this form. So I could say Vi minus I naught by Gm. It could also be the negative of this, right? These two equations are the same, right? Vi minus I naught by Gm is 0, but the thing is here, each of these terms is a voltage. Okay. So this appears fine. So the VGS must be either this or the negative of this. Okay. Now how do I implement this? Vi, of course, I already have. How do I get I naught by Gm? Pass I naught through some resistor. Resistor value must be 1 by Gm. That's all. Okay. So, if I naught goes through this resistor whose value is 1 by Gm, then the voltage across it will be I naught by Gm. Okay? Yeah, that's right. Yeah. So, that's the resistor that I have to have in the circuit to define that transconductance Gm. Okay. So, let us say I want this Gm to be 1 millisiemen. That means that I have to stick a 1 kilo ohm resistor here and pass I naught through it, so that I get I naught divided by 1 millisiemens. Okay. Now, this is true of all controlled current sources, right? A MOS transistor, the current goes from drain to source. Okay. So, it goes from drain to source, and you need both the terminals, because when you have a current output, you will take the current output from one of the terminals and you will do this sensing business at the other terminal. Okay. Isn't it? Because if it is a voltage, you can sense the voltage and you can also use the same voltage to drive something else. All you have to do is connect these things in parallel, right? If I have some voltage Vx, I can drive multiple things with it simply by fanning it out, simply by connecting it to many things. If I have a single current, how do I make it pass through different branches? Effectively everything has to be in series. Okay. So what I am saying is, if this is the load can be driven from this side and the other one can be driven that way. Okay. So where this is the drain and this is the source. You do the sensing at one side and then you drive the current out from the other side. Okay. So clearly this is the load. So this has to be connected to either the drain or the source of the transistor, because that's where you get the current, that's where you can tap the currents of a MOS transistor. Okay. And Vi is available here and I naught by Gm is there. So, what should happen if Vi is more than I naught by Gm? What should you do to the output current? Reduce it, increase it. I naught must increase. So, this means that what should happen to VGS in order for this to happen? VGS also must be increased. VGS must be increasing. It should be positive. Okay. And similarly, if Vi is less than I naught by Gm, it is the opposite scenario. Okay. So now you tell me, if you have a MOS transistor, how will you connect it up? Again, you can go and try all the possibilities and see. So how will you connect it up so that if I naught is greater than 1 by Gm, you will have a positive VGS and an increasing output current. Now, Vi is greater than I naught by Gm. I don't know, maybe I said it wrongly, but if Vi is greater than I naught by Gm, then VGS must be positive. So what should I connect to what? I have to connect the transistor here, right? Okay. And input at the gate. Okay. So the input has to be connected to the gate or the source, that we know. I mean, it can't be connected to the drain for sure, right? So now you can see that if you connect the input to the gate and I naught by GM to the source terminal, then if Vi is more than I naught by GM, then VGS will be positive, a positive current will be drawn from here and so on. So it seems to be in the direction that we want. Is that okay? And we can take the output current from the drain. Okay. So again, if you're not convinced of this reasoning, you can try alternatives and see what happens. You will find that they will not work basically. That's all. Okay. I connect the input to the gate. And I take the output from the drain. And I connect the source to this resistance 1 by GM. Now, this is the definition of output current. Whatever current is flowing here is I naught. Okay. So that will be flowing through the transistor and into this resistor. Okay. So the voltage here is I naught by GM. So VGS is nothing but Vi minus I naught by GM. Okay. So the gate source voltage of the MOS transistor is basically the error voltage that we need for this negative feedback system. Okay. Is this fine? So now please evaluate exactly what the output current will be. What is the value of I naught? Please evaluate this. Conductance is GX. Or if you want it in terms of resistor, it is Rx. And this is some load. You can even ground it for now, we are not interested. The output current is GM times VGS, and VGS itself is this voltage is Vi with respect to ground, no current flows into the gate, and this voltage is I naught Rx or I naught by GX. Okay. So this will give you GM times Vi minus I naught Rx. And if you solve for I naught, you will get Vi times GM by 1 plus GM Rx or GM by GX. Okay. What is the value we wanted? What was the output current we wanted? Vi times GX. Okay. Will this ever be equal to that? When GM tends to infinity. Okay. So again, the transistor's GM has to be very, very large. In that case, you will get basically this will be Vi by Rx or Vi times GX if GM is much more than GX. So in any negative feedback system, you will always have this condition, which is equivalent to saying the loop gain has to be much more than 1. Okay. What will be the value of incremental VGS when GM is infinity? Huh? Incremental VGS when GM is infinity. What is it, Deepak? 0. Yeah. For any finite valued output current, this has to be 0. So again, the gate and source will be virtually shorted. So this voltage will be equal to Vi. So, the current flowing here will be Vi by Rx, and the same thing will flow to the load. That is the idea. With a virtually shorted gate source, that is exactly what happens. Okay. And this expression, does it look similar to what we had earlier for the source follower? What is the difference between this circuit and the source follower? The only thing is, I mean, there I was calling this voltage the output voltage. Now I am calling this current the output current. So this voltage, if you recall, it was GM Rx by 1 plus GM Rx. Now this current is simply this voltage divided by Rx, and that's what is coming out. So it's Gm by 1 plus Gm Rx. So these circuits are all quite closely related to each other. Okay. No, not necessary. Yeah, that's correct. I mean, there is no limit to the Gm value. You go on increasing the bias current and increasing the size of the transistor, you can get any Gm you want. Okay. You have to use a large value of current and large value of W by L. Okay. So there is really, I mean, there are practical limits, but that is true of the previous case also. Remember, the source follower also would work properly only if Gm is much more than Gm is much more than GL. Okay. Here Gm has to be much more than GX. So whatever resistance appears between source and ground, Gm has to be much more than that. That's all. Okay. Is this fine? So you should of course understand this circuit, how to analyze it, and also, I mean, you should understand that all these circuits are not like wildly different from each other. They are pretty much the same thing. So here I am taking the current output. In the previous case, I was taking the voltage output. Okay. So this voltage controlled current source also behaves ideally if Gm is infinity, and in practice, if you want a certain transconductance Gx, you have to start with a MOS transistor which is biased at a much higher transconductance. Okay. So that is essential, but once you do that, the transconductance will be independent of the MOS transistor. It will depend only on this resistance Gx. Okay. Fraction of what? Actually, in this case, that's not possible. I mean, what should be the fraction? Instead of taking I naught Rx, you take a fraction of it as VGS. See, one thing is, I mean, I'll come to the restrictions later, but in a MOS transistor, the source terminal is common to the controlled and controlling sides. Okay, so in a way, it's as though you started off with. So let's say you had a control source like this, okay, voltage controlled current source. Then the controlling side has two separate terminals and controlled side has two separate terminals and nothing is connected to anything else. So in this case, we can do all the stuff that you mentioned. But in the MOS transistor, we don't have that freedom. This is already tied to that. So what you are saying is not possible to do. Okay, with a single MOS transistor, with multiple transistors, you could possibly do that. Okay. So I'll come to some of the restrictions and how to get over them later, but before where? No, getting feedback from there is probably difficult, and then also that will not be a current source anymore. Okay. So if you do something like this and then try to take feedback from there, the resulting structure will not be a current source, because you also want a current source at the output. Okay. That will probably become closer to a voltage source, and it probably won't be negative feedback also. So there are many problems. Now, as far as the gain of this voltage controlled current source is concerned, we are fine. If Gm is very large, we get Gm of the MOS transistor is very large, we get what we want. What should be the input and output resistances of a voltage controlled current source? What should be the input resistance? Infinity. What should be the output resistance? Also infinity. It's a current source. What is it that we have? What is the resistance looking this way? Infinity. No current is flowing there. What is the resistance looking back that way? We have to set Vi to 0. What happens? What will be the resistance between this point and ground? 1 by Gm. Why? What happens if Vi is 0? This voltage is 0. And what will be this voltage? 0. Guaranteed? I don't know. I mean, can you get it from analysis? Will it be 0 or not? This. No, I don't know. You do have, when you measure the output resistance, you have a test voltage between this point and ground. Is it or is it not zero? It is zero. How do you know? Yeah. Yeah. So anyway, you can assume that this is some non-zero voltage. There is a Vs times Gx flowing that way, okay, and Gm Vs flowing that way, right? Because Vgs is minus Vs, and the sum of those two has to be zero. So Vs has to be zero. Okay, so it will be zero. So what will be the current source? The current source becomes an open circuit. Okay. So what is the output resistance? Infinity. Okay. So it looks like it is ideal. Both input and output resistances are infinity, as they should be. Have we left out anything here? Output conductance. So please find out the output resistance with the output conductance of the MOS transistor in place. Okay. With GDS and see what you get. Okay, so please do that before tomorrow's class, and I think